This is my December 2020 solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3 and Kona Electric costs and usage. So stay tuned. Hi, John here, and welcome. In this video, I'm going to take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for the month of December 2020, plus stats and usage information for our Tesla Model 3 and the Hyundai Kona Electric and myenergi, eddi and zappi. Now, I will be publishing in the next few days a full 2020 review of our solar Powerwall and battery electric cars, all of that performance, so therefore I'm going to keep this video fairly brief. In the description down below is a list of all our components for our system, so please have a look down there if you're not familiar with our setup. Let's get straight into it. So in December, we produced a total of 186 kilowatts from our two separate PV arrays. We had an average daily solar generation of just 6 kilowatts for the month. December wasn't a great month for solar. Very, very grey. And you'll certainly see that when we look at the day-to-day chart. So stay tuned, because that's a bit of a doozy. If we look at the solar PV totals for both arrays, our 4 kilowatt array produced 116 kilowatt hours. And our newer 2.34 kilowatt array produced 70 kilowatt hours. Comparing that to December last year with the identical setup, you can see we managed much more solar generation, another 61 kilowatts over the course of the month. 2020, not great for us. So let me know in the comments section down below how you got on with your solar generation if you have solar. I love to hear what your totals were and your system size, and other viewers like to read your comments and see how everyone got on. Thank you in advance to those of you who do comment, and it is really appreciated because it creates data sharing and a sense of community as well. So thank you. So let's look at the Powerwall 2 and solar contribution to our overall self-power. Our Powerwall is in cost-saving mode. We are with Octopus Energy on their agile tariff and cost-saving mode. The battery provides the power to the house for the peak period between 4 p.m. and 7 p.m. every day. That's its underlying principle. During December, we were 34% self-powered from the Powerwall, and the contributions were 26% and 8%, as you can see from the stacked chart. The 8% came from solar generation, and the 26% came from the Powerwall. So the Powerwall was doing all the work, basically more than three times the work, in fact. And it's hardly surprising the Powerwall picked up the slack due to such a low solar production for the month. Let's have a look at the peak and off-peak for our self-power. The Powerwall did a really good job supplying our home's power needs during the peak period between 4 p.m. and 7 p.m. Within the Tesla Powerwall app, I've extended the peak period time slot out to 8 p.m, as electricity unit pricing can sometimes be a little high at that time of night. So in effect, the peak self-power figure here is for 4 hours, from 4 p.m. through to 8 p.m. The percentages on this chart represents the performance of the Powerwall's ability to supply the house rather than pulling from the grid to meet the house's needs. The months along the bottom are only populated with data when we are in cost-saving mode with the Powerwall. The red columns represent the 4-hour peak time, and looking at December 2020's column, for 99% of the time in that 4-hour peak period, we were on battery power with no pull from the grid. Well, just 1% was grid energy during that peak time. I don't actually have the exact figures yet, as my electricity bill hasn't arrived in time for making this video. However, extracting the data from the Octopus Watch app, it shows 2.88 kilowatt hours of usage for a cost of 74 pence for that 1% of grid pull during the peak rates over the course of the month. So sort of small change then, really. The green column represents the remaining 20 hours of the day. During that time, we were on battery and solar for just 5% of the time. Grey, dull, short, daylight winter days are the worst for solar generation. Still, at least the shortest day has been and gone, and now we are starting to edge toward more daylight. Each day, around 2 minutes extra per day. Let's have a look at the PV year-on-year chart. Here's the month of December solar generation, going back to 2011. The totals for years 2011 to 2018 will be for the original 4-kilowatt system. The 2019 and 2020 figures are for both arrays. If you recall, the original 4-kilowatt array produced 116 kilowatt hours in December 2020, making it the second worst December. December 2015 pipping it to the worst month by just 5 kilowatt hours. The new array are managed 70 kilowatts, giving us the 186 kilowatt hour total that you see there. Powerwall in and out, very brief look at that. The Powerwall had an 89% round trip efficiency for the month for what we managed to store versus what the Powerwall was able to supply. We stored 347 kilowatt hours and it supplied back 310 kilowatt hours. Let's skip along merrily to the day by day. This chart gives you what happened on a sort of day by day usage. The legend is blue is house usage, yellow is solar generation, orange is export to the grid, and red is import from the grid. Where is the yellow, I hear you ask? Have you forgotten to add that data, John? No, it is there. There were just 5 days during the month where we saw solar production above 15 kilowatt hours in a single day. For the first time ever, we had 1 day with zero generation. That was on the 23rd of December. Previously, our lowest recorded generation was on December 26th and 27th of 2019 at 400 watts on each day. I never thought I would see zero solar generation in a day. But there you go. So how did everyone else get on towards the end of December? Was your December 23rd as bad as ours? So comment down below with your worst day of solar generation this year. Let's have a look at December 2020 overall totals. So this chart shows the overall totals for the 4 data sources we've just looked at in the day by day. I guess the house usage is the key one here at 1.265 kilowatt hours of usage over the course of the month. And most of that would have been coming from the grid due to the poor solar production for the month. I'm going to skip forward because I'm about to cover the grid usage in a little more detail, so I won't dwell on it on this particular chart. So this chart shows our average daily house usage and our average daily grid uses over the month. Our average daily house usage was up against November's at 40.8 kilowatt hours, from 31.6 kilowatt hours, and that's the blue line. On average each day we pulled 36.5 kilowatt hours from the grid, again up on November's figures of 22.8 kilowatt hours, and that's the red line. This is what we sent to the grid. So we sent 24.6 kilowatt hours of excess solar generated back to the grid in December. This was towards the beginning of the month on the 5th and 6th of December. We were actually out all day and I forgot to plug in one of the cars before we left home. And both days were surprisingly sunny. Hey ho. So this tracks what we pulled from the grid each month, a total of 1,131 kilowatt hours from the grid. And I guess there were two reasons for this increase in grid usage this month. One is less solar production, and two, there were a few days of negative or plunge pricing which we took advantage of to charge up one of the cars and the power wall, run the dishwasher, washing machines and so on. There was also some very low electricity rates on some very windy days, so we benefited there too. So whilst the grid usage does actually look high, the electricity bill will not reflect that, as there are some credits in there as well and some very, very low rates. If we look across to December 2019, you can see that we used less in 2020 than we did in 2019. So 1131 kilowatt hours versus 1299 kilowatt hours. So a small token takeaway there. I'm now hoping that we're heading towards lower grid usage as the months progress. Looking at the historical charts, that seems likely. However, you can never tell with the Great British weather. Another beast from the east like we had in 2018 will certainly knock all that on the head. Let's have a look at the eddi. This chart is for the eddi, which heats our hot water by diverting excess solar energy once the Tesla Powerwall battery is full. Lack of sunshine clearly had an impact here, with just 6 kilowatt hours of electricity diverted from excess solar. Let's move on to the Zappi. This is the Zappi for December 2020. It covers the Tesla Model 3 and the Hyundai Kona. So the Tesla Model 3 has covered 178 miles during the month, bringing its total mileage to 8,170 miles. We did one supercharging session at Y Boston Lakes, which is the first time we've been there. It's fairly new to us as well, so that was nice. We were Billy No Mates there, by the way. And it was free because we have referral miles. So thank you to those people that have used our referral code when purchasing their Tesla and gained 1,000 free supercharging miles each. We were also, while we were charging, we were in center mode, which you can see there on the screen. The remainder, or shall I say the reindeer, of the charge was all done at home on the Zappi. We added 155.79 kilowatt hours, of which just a measly 1% was from excess solar energy. That 1% works out at 4.86 kilowatt hours. So the other 99% was from the grid. And again, all at cheap off-peak rates. As I mentioned earlier, we also had some plunge pricing and negative pricing during December, which we took advantage of to top up the Tesla. In terms of working out the costs here, I've used an average of 6 pence per kilowatt to calculate the costs, as I've, again, not had the Octopus Agile December bill through yet. So the 178 miles covered in the Tesla during the month cost us 0.05 pounds per mile. The Kona covered 220 miles in the month and now has a total mileage of 10,702 miles. We did one public charging in the Kona at Rushden Lakes Pod Point, which was on Free Vend, and added 13 kilowatt hours. So we were there all day. The remaining 100.64 kilowatt was added at home by the Zappi. So the 220 miles covered in the Kona during the month cost us 0.03 pounds per mile. So finally, please comment, like and share. Any of those actions really help to get the video shown to more people, which in turn obviously helps my channel grow. Thank you for watching. And I will see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.